with Cars, a North American street stock series that marries Canadian racers with their counterparts from the United States. Street stock cars modified only slightly for speed and safety, racing on molded Hoosier radial tires. It's four classes, one race, four different winners. The first race of Speed Weeks is just moments away.
Bill, let's talk about pit strategy. In a lot of series, they talk about how small that fuel window is. A driver has to bring his car onto pit road at the exact lap to make sure he has fuel to make it to the end. Not the case today. By my calculations, the pit window here today is 53 minutes long. Why? These cars can go about an hour and a half on fuel. The reason they have to come in at a specific time, 26 minutes a driver has to drive. That's 25% of the distance to score points. So look for these drivers to wait for a yellow flag. They can wait all the way till nearly the end of the race, as long as there's 26 minutes left to come in for fuel. They'll all do it if they see a yellow flag. Bob?
All right, thanks, gentlemen. We are ready for some fun here at Daytona. I'm Bob Varsha, along with Jeremy Dale and Marty Reed. I've not driven these cars. These guys have. He's a Canadian. He's an American. I'm not going to be a referee. You guys figure it out. What's going to happen?
Well, I think it's pretty clear, Bob. A Canadian's going to win this race.
No. I'm so confident about the Americans, I will bet you that the loser has to sing the other's national anthem.
Well, I hope you know the words to the Canadian anthem, because I don't know the words to the American anthem.
Well, neither did Roseanne Barr, but it didn't stop her.
That's okay, Jeremy. We'll write the words down for you. Here's a look at the makeup to today's field. 37 cars, 83 drivers, actually from three countries. We have a Portuguese driver in the field. 15 different makes and models, and they break down like this. The heavy-breathing grand sports cars, the bulk of the class. We have sports cars, touring cars, and compacts. Speed differentials galore. We are going to be mixing some traffic here today at Daytona. Now take a look at the starting grid. Two Pontiacs on the front row, then the Ford Mustang for actor racing driver Jason Priestley from Beverly Hills 90210. He's actually driving with Canadian Scott Maxwell. Let's hope we don't get a slugfest in the pits. Now, as we mentioned, most of the cars up front are the grand sports cars, but we'll also have the sports class. We'll have all of those different makes and models we talked about earlier, 15 in all, going at it. They have roll cages and fire extinguishers installed. The engines are blueprinted to manufacturer specifications for ultimate horsepower. And of course, Hoosier tires on all four wheels, or as our Canadian friends like to say, Hoosiers. All right, gentlemen, you've both raced in a series just like this one, if not this series. What do we expect when the green flag drops?
Well, I think, this is the start of a new series, and I think there are going to be some bragging rights on the line here with all of these drivers, both the Canadians and the Americans. I think they probably feel like they've got a little bit of something to prove with each other.
I'll definitely agree with that. And keep your eye on that front row, especially our pole sitter, the Hainer-Heinrich team. That group finished third here last year. They've always raced these cars very well. They've been together for it seems like an eternity.
They are lining up two by two in NASCAR's turns 3 and 4. But we're going to be using not only the tri-oval that the big stockers will be using for the Daytona 500, we'll also have the infield course, 3.56 miles in all. That's the view from the Bud One airship, looking down on pole sitter Stu Hainer, starting alongside the similar 98 Pontiac Firebird of Devin Powell from Port Perry, Ontario.
Devin, of course, son of John Powell, in Canada, certainly a famous racing instructor, a very good racing school that John runs up there. You can see the pace car is really holding out to the last moment here.
And I'll make a correction before we get started. Jason Priestley, I've just discovered, is also Canadian, so he and Scott Maxwell will be doing just fine. And now they scatter high and low. Will they be 3 and 4 wide as we take the green? No. Back into line they go as they head for turn one.
Yeah, a couple of guys down on the apron there, and there's nothing in the rules that says you can't use that apron. The problem is when you get down to turn one, it gets a little tight. Side by side here.
A couple of guys are using the dirt down there in turn one.
Yeah, I saw three abreast there through the apex of turn two. They've got to pretty much go single file here. Oh, here we go. Mustang very sideways.
Whoa.
certainly a little bit of help there. And of course, gets the wheel spinning, trying to get back onto the racetrack.
That's the 53 Mustang Cobra of J.J. Kelly and Kenneth Goldberg.
So much for their qualifying effort.
39 has also gone around.
And that again is the International Horseshoe on the infield. We've got a replay here. This is coming through turn two. You can see those cars down at the apex there, and the Mustang almost saves it here, but just the Firebird just keeps pushing and won't let up and really forces that Mustang around.
The 39 car we saw go around was Steve McNeely sharing that car with Scott Harrington. But this is the kind of thing you see when you have so many cars that are equally prepared, very close on horsepower, very close to the other members of their class in top speed. Sometimes the racing can get fairly forthright.
Well, and early in a race like this, everyone, you know, jockeying for position is a real cliche, but certainly they want to, you know, set the tone for the race. They don't want to lose touch with the leader. This is down the back straight into the chicane, the bus stop, as we call it.
What kind of top speed in this area?
Oh, probably about 145, close to 150 miles an hour for some of these cars coming down into the bus stop. Very hard on the brakes. And this is a place where we always see lots of dirt being kicked up.
That's John Kohler going underneath there.
Moving well up on the high banks. What an experience for these drivers, many of whom may not have raced Daytona before, to get up there on the high banks and rock at top speed around this track.
And I can tell you, the first time you get up there, you know, television just does not do the banking justice. To go back to the front of the field here, the 32 car through turn two, completing the first lap. This is the area where timing and scoring is, so until they get to that point, they really haven't completed a lap. Through the International Horseshoe. Lots of Firebirds up at the front, Mustangs as well. The Mustangs very strong on horsepower. The Firebirds a little bit stronger on the handling and on the braking.
Side by side, Burnell Cochran and Devin Powell down to Bill Weber.
And keep your eye on Bernie Cochran in that two car. He's a talented young driver, 30 years old, would like to do a little NASCAR Busch Series racing this year. But his co-driver in that car is David Murray. And 12 years ago, when Bernie went to driving school, David Murray was his instructor. They are co-driving that car today. Bernie's been very fast, so has David. Currently in second place on the track, they think they've got a good shot at winning, and they plan to pit as early as possible, especially if they should get a caution period, say 30 or 35 minutes into this race.
You know, I think I actually did that race in school with David Murray. That was a good driver's school. I remember Bernie Cochran.
The one thing you have to remember, they have to go a minimum of 20 minutes before they can make the driver change. Boy, look at that lead that Hayner has built up.
Here's some drafting down the back straight. The Mustang,
very hard on the brakes.
Very nice move, very solid. And moves up into third place. Some debris there. We don't know where that came from exactly.
Jason really made a big step in his career last year when he teamed up with Andy Pilgrim in this series. And he really moved to the head of the class and became a serious driver.
And I think that has been the big difference for him, is he's got some teammates. He's teamed with Scott Maxwell in many different cars and, of course, Andy Pilgrim, and both of whom are very good drivers. And that has really helped his driving.
Good battle here for fifth going on. Through the tri-oval, heading down to turn one. They'll be hard on the brakes right here.
And I thought I saw a little point by there by the Mustang. I saw his hand come up off the wheel, but he certainly hasn't let him go.
Down to Yabikas.
Talking about braking, and having spoken with many of these drivers, they say that the brakes are the weak link on these cars, that you cannot go out and drive these production-based cars flat out like you can some of the other race cars here for the 24 hours of Daytona. So when you see a driver point someone by like you thought you saw, Jeremy, oftentimes they will do that because they do not want to abuse the brakes going into the corners, because they know at the end of the race they have got to have those brakes under them.
Number 18 in white, the Ford Mustang, is Nick Longhi. Just behind him is the 94 beautifully painted Powell Motorsport Chevy Camaro, Peter Lockhart from Toronto. Right now the field's stringing out just a little bit. Nobody making a passing attempt. do. Here's a look at the top 10 as they run at this moment. Stu Hayner, followed by Coughlin, Priestley, Powell, Longhi, Lockhart. We'll be back with more of the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-Hour from Daytona International Speedway. Back live at Daytona International Speedway, Bob Varsha along with Jeremy Dale and Marty Reed with you. Bill Weber and Jan Bikas are in the pit road and way out in front all by himself in his Pontiac Firebird Formula. Stu Hayner, look at the gap he has opened up over the second place car of Bernie Cochran.
And again, this is where we've seen most of the passing so far, down into the chicane. Nice hard straight braking zone there after a good long straightaway. Look at that little slide there turning into the left.
Everybody using that dirt verge. If they get a lot of that sandy dirt up there, it's going to make traction very, very hard to find in that hard right-hander.
Well, the drivers were warned as we look up above on the Bud Airship. If they cut that corner too many times, they would be black flag because they did not want that danger zone to be chewed up with all that dirt coming out.
Another car takes the low line through the high banks.
Yeah, look at those Mustangs have definitely got some horsepower. They've never been short on horsepower and top speed, but they kind of hurt a little bit on the braking. Look at the Firebird there close up very heavily under braking into turn one.
Those two Mustangs are from TF Racing. That's John Kohler in the second car and Sonagera from Portugal in the lead car, the 17 car.
We're not going to have to do any Portuguese national anthem, are we?
No, because there's no way I know that one.
Puff of tire smoke there in the International Horseshoe, or the East Horseshoe, as it's known here at Daytona International Speedway. The infield section now.
And they're probably down to about 35 to 40 miles an hour before they accelerate back up. This is a great section of racetrack. The kink here, flat out in fourth gear, and then hard on the brakes for the second hairpin in the infield.
Field beginning to string out now, as we expected they would, with four classes of cars all racing together. Some more side-by-side action. Ooh, lighting up the left front.
Oh, yeah. And he really kept it lit up. And that tire, I guarantee you now, is flat-spotted. And so we may see more brake lockup from that car.
Was the Mustang of Chuck Snipes from Goldsboro, North Carolina. And it's another thing we should point out about racing what are essentially street cars. The suspensions are not meant to take the heavy cornering loads. It's not at all unusual to see the rear end come right off the ground, or at least one corner of the rear come off the ground. The front's locking up under heavy stress. Down to Jan Bikas.
Bob, there's an update from the course that the Ford Mustang of Jason Priestley and Scott Maxwell is leaking fuel. Now, oftentimes these cars do leak a little fuel because they fill them up to the absolute top, and over the first few laps they do leak. But it is a concern for the officials, so keep an eye out for car number zero if it continues and they have to come on pit road.
Well, and boy, we just saw Jason there. That first part of the chicane with a big slide put the left side wheels off the racetrack and then pulled it back on before the second part of the chicane. So he is not stroking. He is driving very hard.
And again, we talked about the fact that you have to give this car over to your co-driver in good condition. John pointed out the brake situation. Yes, we can see it right there. The fuel is coming out, John. Don't go anywhere because it looks like they may have to bring that car in. I mean, it's not a little leak either, guys.
No, but you know, what they do before the race is they fill the car up absolutely to the maximum, right up into the neck. They get every last ounce of fuel into the car. And of course, once they start driving it, it does slosh back and forth. So after about five laps, they should burn off enough that you should see that go away. That problem should go away.
Fourth place car, Devin Powell, the bright yellow machine to the right of your screen. Longhi just behind him in the white Ford Mustang.
Great battles here between the Fords and the GM products, both the Camaros and the Firebirds.
Whoops, and a problem. That's the Portuguese driver, I believe. Leonardo Sonagera.
Do you guys know what Tim Hortons is?
It's a donut shop, isn't it?
There you go, very good.
Named for a hockey player. Yeah, I know my Canadian history.
I'm not sure that qualifies as history, but okay.
Well, he was running eighth, and unfortunately, it won't run on donuts. It needs some horsepower, and it's got it right now.
Now, he's down on the apron going very slowly, and he is a long way from home here. And I'm looking at the right front on this thing. Oh, no, that tire's okay.
So Bernardo Sanaguera remains on his way around to Bill Weber.
Well, Jeff Ripley is the crew chief on Jason Priestley's car, and he just told the race official that that gasoline spillage is probably going to continue, but only briefly. It's part of the design of the car because of the banking and because of the amount of fuel and the design of the tank. There's actually an overflow valve there to let some of that fuel spill out to keep air from getting in there. But he has told the official, they're standing with him now, that that will continue, but it should go away very briefly. His exact words were, please be patient.
Well, it's happening on the infield. It's not happening on the bank. Right there on the left-hander, it is coming out as he's going down through ones, two, and three.
But, you know, that is classic. The crew chief goes to the infield. No, it is designed to spit fuel out in left-hand corners. No, it's really supposed to do that.
So the battle is going on in the pits as well as on the racetrack. At least the leak is behind that rear wheel and not in front of it. We'll take a break and be back with more live from Daytona. Back live at Daytona International Speedway with shadows growing long as the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-hour continues. It's car number 32, Stu Hayner, the race leader, who rocketed away from the field at the green flag. He's been extending his lead as he now mixes it up with the three other classes around his Grand Sport Pontiac. There's the second place car. I said Hayner moving away. Actually, car number two, Bernie Cochran, appears to be closing up, and traffic might have something to do with that. Whoops, there is Jason Priestley, who is using every bit of the pavement in his Ford Mustang, running third, but we're still watching the right rear corner of the car in left-hand turns. It appears to be leaking fuel. There is the fourth place car, car number 11. Devin Powell from Port Perry, Ontario, another Pontiac Firebird. And the 21 blue Ford Mustang of Chuck Snipes from Goldsboro, North Carolina.
And right there is where he lit up the tires before when he got wide again.
And I think he did the same thing, just not as bad. But I think that the braking is really hurting him now.
Nick Longy comes down in the white Ford Mustang to take the position on the banking.
And this kills you all the way around to the bus stop chicane, because if you don't come off turn six very well, you end up sucking wind at the other end.
Well, he's got a good draft here, but the question is the braking going to be any good? Now, Nick stays to the left, forces the other car around to the outside, but we think that the braking is compromised here. And he stays fairly close there on the entry. You can see these cars are very well matched on top speed, on horsepower. Nick does a little bit better through the chicane, although doesn't track it up to the wall, which is very interesting.
Well, if Chuck Snipes can keep this car together, his co-driver, Randy Popes, is a former champion. So if he can bring that car in with some brakes and some tire, of course, they'll have to probably change that tire if it's flat spotted too badly. But you're right, he's closing in on him again here on the front straight.
Checking the interval now. Back to the next car in line. There it is, the Sunoco-sponsored blue and yellow Chevy Camaro SS of Peter Lockhart from Toronto, Ontario, Canada.
Yay.
Well, that was a spirited cheer.
I'm trying to cheer my guys on.
Right now, you got one that's leaking fuel.
Peter, very, very experienced. Been racing for many years. Started out in Formula Ford 2000 cars and has been running these production-based cars. You can see a little something flapping underneath the car there. It doesn't look too serious. We're not sure what it is.
Oh,
there's some more lockup into the International Horseshoe.
It's John Kohler.
And boy, these guys really mixing it up. There's an M3 BMW, kind of the first glance at one of those M3s that we've seen.
John Kohler from Bradford, Pennsylvania.
Look at the M3, very good on the brakes. Very, very good on the brakes.
Pass for position, car 54, the BMW M3 of Andy Pilgrim.
Now look at these guys coming up on some of the slower cars that are also racing. Now this Miata and this Neon are racing for position, and they've got the BMW and the Mustang Look at the Mustang, just has to thread the needle there.
So Andy Pilgrim moves into ninth.
And they start at 25th.
Look at the horsepower in the Mustang.
Now, we mentioned that there is a pit stop coming up, a mandatory stop with a driver change for everybody involved. That has to be performed within a pit window that opens up in about a minute's time. So we'll be looking for pit stops starting very shortly.
The problem with the 54 car this morning was I made a bad rear end, a broken rear end, so that's why they started so far back. But under braking, well, I'll tell you what, the BMW is one car you won't have to worry about the brakes.
No, you can run those brakes as hard as you want. Of course, that car is lighter than the Mustangs and the Firebirds. It's not carrying as much weight. The terminal velocity isn't quite as high. Look at the closing rate there by the Mustang. That blimp shot really illustrates that very well. I mean, that's just horsepower there. You see the BMW close up again under braking. And as you said, Marty, the guys in the BMWs can use the brakes just about as hard as they want all the time.
You see from our field summary, the top runner in the sportsman class is in 20th place right now. It's car number 81. It's a BMW 328 of Jeff McMillan. Bill Weber in the pit lane on the number four.
Well, in that four car, the driver is Bob Walton. Now, you might remember his late father, Sam. Yes, of the Walmart fame. Bob is chairman of the board of Walmart, and he's co-driving with Don Knowles, who is the former deputy undersecretary of the Interior and an excellent race car driver. And Don has really brought Bob Walton along. He's having a fun run and a good run here, and his driving talent, as well as his marketing and selling skills, are pretty good.
So the battles continue all the way around this 3.56 mile racetrack. Look at that lineup of cars in the short chute out of the West hairpin as they head for the banking another time. There's car number 17, our Portuguese driver, Ricardo Senoguera, who was having problems earlier. No problems, however, out front. We'll be back with more from Daytona in just a moment. Is officially underway here at Daytona International Speedway with today's Motorola Daytona 2-Hour. Coming up tomorrow, we'll be on the grid for the granddaddy of endurance races in the United States, the Rolex 24 at Daytona. On the grid at 12:30 p.m. Eastern time, and then at 1 p.m. Eastern, the race gets underway. 24 hours for 79 cars from around the world. We'll have 3 hours of coverage going to 4 p.m. Eastern time. Then we'll cover the race throughout the night and bring you all of the highlights as we get set for 6 hours of live coverage of the run to the checkered flag at the Rolex 24. These great shots high above Daytona International Speedway being brought to you by the Bud One Airship. Best seat in the house today definitely is inside Bud One, ambassador for the King of Beers. Here in the Daytona 2-Hour, Stu Hayner continues to have his way. Here's a good example of the speed differential between the grand sports cars and the compacts. Meanwhile, Stu Hayner might be glancing at his mirrors every now and then, because coming up quickly from behind is the second-place car of David Murray.
Yeah, that gap is only 2.2 seconds. Now, of course, they've started to lap slower cars, so it's natural to see that gap close up.
Excuse me, I said David Murray. It's his teammate, Bernie Cochran, in the car right now. Murray will finish.
It's down to under a second, and look at these close. I'm wondering if Stu might, he looks a little slow through that corner, and Bernie really closes on him. I don't know if that was a lap traffic.
You see the kudos won by Stu Hayner back in 1996. Experienced in any number of different types of race cars, but right now he's got a battle on his hands as Bernie Cochran.
It looks like they've got fairly clear racetrack up ahead, but that never lasts for very long. You see that gap opens up just a little bit, but in this type of racing, you never really get clean laps. You might get half a lap fairly clean, but it won't be long before they're back into the lap track.
Whoa, got a little tail happy on Bernie's car coming out of there. A couple of things we need to think about here. The rules have changed regarding pit stops. It used to be that if you could get that big lead, a yellow would come out, you could duck into the pits. Now the pits are closed. That team, the Phoenix American Motorsports team, they might be just sort of pacing themselves right now with Steve Hayner and waiting for that rather than burning up the car. Bill, you got something else on that?
Well, we can ask John Heinrichsen. He's co-driver with Stu Hayner in that 32 car. What is your strategy here, John?
Well, Stu's going to stay in. As long as we have a green track, he'll go until about an hour and 15 minutes, and then I'll get in for the last 30 minutes. And Stu's running like Stu does. You know, he's running conservative and quick, taking care of the car, making sure he's got a great car for me when I get in, and I love it.
So you say conservative. Does that explain why the two car is closing in?
Stu's been getting held up over at the bus stop by some of the slower class cars the last several laps going through there. So that really hurts him because he's really good through the bus stop. And that's hurting his time a little bit, but he'll make it up.
Okay, we'll see what happens. I did talk to Bernie Cochran's father, who is Bernie Cochran, and Bernie's father said that Bernie Jr. hasn't said a word on the radio since the race started.
All right, thank you, Bill. Checking the gaps between cars. Looking for car number 54. Where are you?
Right there.
Am I dating myself?
Just a little. We saw that in reruns, right?
This is the BMW, now moved up to seventh position. So working, it looks like, oh boy, he had me fooled there. I thought he was almost heading for the pit lane. He just runs very low through the tri-oval.
It's Andy Pilgrim in the 54 BMW. Back live at Daytona International Speedway for round one of the Motorola Cup in 1998. We have a great battle up front. Stu Hayner, the race leader, ducking in and out of traffic. That's the second place car just getting out of traffic. It's time to head for the bus stop chicane. Bernie Cochran at the controls.
Yeah, Bernie didn't have the best angle for entry in that corner and held on to it very nicely. And there's the slow attack that they worked their way around.
Examples of some of the other classes in action here at Daytona.
It's interesting. I've been looking at Bernie's car, and it's very peculiar to me. It looks like it has an awful lot of front ride height. It looks like it's really putting a lot of air under the nose of that car.
Well, let's see what we can learn about the front runner. Here's Bill Weber.
Well, Stu Hayner has not talked to his crew, and the crew says that's a good sign because it indicates nothing is wrong with the car. As you guys have alluded to, Stu has a lot of experience, and when he gets out on the track, he likes to race. Keep that in mind.
Not sure that front end ride height thing you noticed, Jeremy, wasn't just the body work on the car. There's a flash of yellow underneath the nose.
Yeah, it's very interesting. The cars have a different look, but we also understand that Stu Hayner's car is not a brand new car. It's about 4 years old.
Let's check in on the sports class battle right now. A pair of BMW 328 ISs out front. Jeff McMillan in the number 81 car, leading Michael Culver at the controls of the number 22 BMW. It is car number 81. Jeff McMillan from Erie, Pennsylvania.
These BMW 328s were essentially dominant last year in the professional sports car street stock series. Quite different from the M3. Quite a bit heavier, not nearly as powerful. The same basic platform, but not nearly as quick a car.
Saw that 92 mile an hour average. Keep in mind, that's exactly what it is around this racetrack. Long stretches of open stock car oval to go as fast as the car will run. But there's a lot of very slow, twisty bits on the infield section that brings that average speed down. So these guys really are smoking on the straightaways.
Here we are back up front here. Bernie Cochran in the two car, Chase Hayner on the bus stop up onto the banking.
It's going to be interesting to see what happens when each team decides to make its pit stop.
While we're watching this, I just noticed down in the pits the 21 of Chuck Snipes did come in. They had the hood up momentarily, and they're about to go a lap down, so that was not a scheduled stop, and they're still in pit lane, and boy, it's a long way back to third, guys.
They're looking for the number 0 Ford Mustang being driven by Jason Priestley.
And he is about 15 seconds back. And this is not this is a very hard job. If you're wondering why our cameraman is having a tough time, it's very hard to pick those cars out. And there is Jason there in the zero car.
That's the lead Canadian car, by the way.
Hey, it's not over, buddy. It's not over.
You may need to start clearing your throat.
There's that designed in fuel leak there. still leaking 15 laps into the race, but, you know.
Just keep thinking, what? Oh, say can you see? That's the first two points.
No, I'm wondering if this race stays green, if that really becomes a serious problem, because they do not have the largest fuel tank in the series.
No, I mean, you can look at it two ways. On the one hand, you can say, you know, this car is leaking fuel, and that's a safety hazard. In the more practical sense, that's fuel that they could burn, which, you know, would give them more flexibility on their pit stop. There's the 11 car, the yellow Firebird. That is the fourth place car.
John Bikas has more on that situation.
Yes, Devin Powell is behind the wheel as we speak, and he has radioed back to the crew that the seat has come loose, not from the actual chassis itself, but the seat adjuster. So while he's trying to drive that car, the seat, is sliding forward and back. He's going to have to live with that until about 1 hour into the race when they will make their mandatory pit stop. Also, they're not too concerned about dropping off of second place. They're saying they're saving the car. It's a brand new one, and they think it'll be fast at the end.
And actually, we had an interesting story on this car because they were having, this is the brand new car with the aluminum block based on the Corvette, and this actually started life as a leased car. And I wonder if the guy that leased them the car actually knows what that car is doing at this very moment.
Watching a battle for fifth and sixth, 54 and 18. While we were watching Devin, we saw that lurid slide by the number 22 BMW. That was the second place car in the sports class, Michael Culver.
And I spoke to Michael before the race, and he said, you know, you're going to give us lots of attention. I said, hey, you know, do something that gives us a reason to give you lots of attention. And he did it.
He did
it.
Okay. Andy Pilgrim in that bright white BMW, center of your screen, from Cooper City, Florida. He continues to move forward. So the vastly experienced Andy Pilgrim could be a factor in who wins this race. Keep in mind, there are pit stops to come. So the race will continue in the pit lane as well as on the racetrack. And over to Terry Borchler later on. We'll take a break and return with more live coverage of the Motorola Cup Daytona 2 Hours. Stand by. Coming out of the glare of a setting sun, live at Daytona International Speedway, the Motorola Daytona 2 Hour continues. There's your race leader, Stu Hayner, in traffic, Bill Weber.
And while he's in traffic, his teammate's car, the 33 car, is here on pit road. And that's driven by Jim McCallion and Mike Weinberg, according to what's going on down here. But here's the key. These guys are able to check their tires. And as the booth alluded to a few minutes ago, tire wear is a big question mark here. So we'll have to wait and see what happens. But this gives them an advantage to see if they might need to change tires when the race leader comes in when he makes his stop.
The information we're getting, Bill, is that Jim McCallion moved over to the Team 35 car, and it's Bob Rockwood getting into the number 33. If you watch the team car that leads this race, as he has since the green flag, that is Stu Hayner.
We were talking about tires. I had a chance to talk to Bernie Cochran. I said, tell me about the Hoosier. He says, well, the one characteristic he noticed as we see him coming through the traffic there is that you can't seem to pitch the car as much as you did the year before on the older tires. And so you have to be sure of your line, and you have to track it in and track it out.
Yeah, you've got to be more tidy. And this is a battle for position. This is Andy Pilgrim in fifth position, closing in on the 11 car.
Andy, one of five drivers in this field who will also be taking part in the Rolex 24 beginning tomorrow afternoon. In addition to Andy Pilgrim, David Murray, Scott Maxwell, Jason Priestley, and Jay Cochran will be going 24 hours beginning at 1 o'clock tomorrow.
Now remember, he started in 25th spot. He is only 28 seconds behind the race leader, and he's had to pick his way through all that 20-car track.
Yeah, I've been watching his lap times, and basically on a consistent basis, I would say average lap time-wise, he has been better than anyone else.
Question then becomes, is he using too much of the car now? Will have anything left?
Well, but that goes back to what we were talking about before. The car is a lighter car, so it's bound to be easier on tires. It's got better brakes. It does not have the top speed. And if Daytona is one thing, you know, it is a top speed kind of racetrack, but it does help to have the good brakes. And to get through the traffic, you need good brakes.
By the way, that's a Canadian. He's close to
across the start-finish line goes Andy Pilgrim. Yeah, you can sit up. It's gonna make you both sing each other's national anthems.
At the same time.
After I leave the announcement.
Yeah, right, after everyone turns the channel.
You can see the bodywork package on this 98 Firebird is very different. That hood has a very different shape. Of course, this M3, pretty much a carryover car from last year.
Meanwhile, we have more pit action. Here's Jan Bikas.
21, car 21, the budget rent-a-car Ford is in here in the pits. It's the second time or third that it has been on pit road. The crew is looking for a misfire. And obviously, that is something that's going to severely hamper the power output of this Ford Mustang. They're looking for whatever they can find, but right now, it does not appear as though they see a whole lot of hope. But it's a long race. They will try their best to find it and get them back out on the racetrack, guys.
Well, it's a long race, but it's not that long. And they go down a lap or two, and that's really going to hurt them. And this gap continues to close up here between fourth and fifth.
Andy Pilgrim in the white BMW. Closing up.
This is where you hate to be in the underpowered car. This is where, you know, when the big horsepower car just pulls out and pulls away from you, it's very frustrating.
Yeah, but watch how much ground he eats up here coming under the brakes.
Absolutely. On under braking and through this chicane, these transitions are very important from left to right and back from right to left. As you go through the chicane, that's all about handling.
Evan Powell, yellow number 11, Pilgrim in the white 54 BMW. Now we look for that Pontiac to draw away a bit on the banking.
Interesting line. You notice how Andy stays low?
Yeah, I think that this is more of a distance issue for Andy. He doesn't need to be up high on the banking, so he figures the low line is the shorter distance around.
Meanwhile, race leader Stu Hayner in car number 32 continues to work the traffic. He's on the infield portion just as the battle we just watched across the start-finish line. Imagine how far ahead he is. A little over 20 seconds. There's how they're running. We'll be right back. Back live at Daytona International Speedway, watching a great battle here as the Motorola Cup Daytona 2 hours continues. The white number 54 BMW is Andy Pilgrim. Devin Powell in the number 11 yellow Pontiac. They've been going at it this entire lap. Let's pick it up in the infield.
And this is through the kink. This is the exit of the kink, and Devin, we didn't see it on a replay, Devin had a huge slide through the kink and had to just check up early, and Andy said, okay, I'll take that position.
That moved Andy Pilgrim into fourth place, but when they pulled up on the stock car banking, it was horsepower time.
Yeah, can you say top speed and horsepower? And here's Devin, and very surprisingly, I mean, he gets by him, which is not a surprise, but then he leaves the door open, and Andy comes right back at him under braking, takes that position back, and that's it.
Well, but you got to remember, Devin's 20 years old, and Andy about, what, 40, 41, and he's a winner last year here in GT1 category in the 24 hours. So talk about experience.
Hundreds of laps of Daytona experience for Andy Pilgrim. Devin Powell getting his first look at this great race track. Now Pilgrim able to draw away in that BMW. Devin Powell, in fact, is going to need to have a glance in his mirror. Car number 18 is coming up behind him.
Yeah, Nick
Longy.
Nick Longy closing that gap. And again, watching the lap times, Nick about a second and a half quicker that last lap than Devin Powell. So maybe Devin, maybe we're finding out a little bit about tires here. Maybe Devin running a little bit hard on those tires, maybe overheating them just a touch. That's very easy to do with a big heavy car.
Less than an hour remaining in the race, under the 1 hour mark. And that compresses the pit stop window for those who will stop to change drivers. The battle to watch in the pits. Imagine these front-running cars, the pit crews are probably looking at one another to get some kind of an indication of when the other guy is going to pit. Rolling along, Stu Haener headed for the International Horseshoe another time. Plenty of racing still to come. We have it live for you as the crews stand and wait. We'll be right back.
Back live at Daytona, Jason Priestley has brought his Ford Mustang back onto pit road. Not only did they change drivers with Maxwell getting behind the wheel, they also changed four tires. The stop took 1 minute and 27 seconds, 0.45. So the big story may be early in the race here, in fact, that the tires are needing changing. So we'll check into this further and check on tire wear. Certainly, that was an unexpected tire change. Maybe everyone up and down pit road will be thinking about it now.
Well, the number 11 car coming out just behind. Devin Powell brought it in. Doug Goad has taken over, and there's a new set of Hoosiers on that car as well.
And now the strategy plays out. We know that everybody's going to have to change tires. A year ago, these tires would go 3 to 4 hours, but obviously this new compound, and we should point out that Hoosier just signed on to this about 2-3 weeks ago, so they'll be working with the compound, I'm sure, to get more life out of it, but now everybody's going to have to change, and now you're going to try and stretch as long as you can so that you can stay out there, as long as you're not losing track space, and then you make a change, maybe on your own.
These pit stops have juggled the order, not the leader, Stu Haener. Behind him is Bernie Cochran, and then the man to the left of your screen, Andy Pilgrim, who continues to march through this field. He still has his pit stop ahead of him. Woo.
That was John Kohler that lit the tires up on the 47 Mustang.
That's the third place car. Right now shown 29.18 seconds behind the leader, so he is not closing on the leader, even as he moves up the leaderboard. In fact, he has a long way to go to the second place car, Bernie Cochran, about 23 seconds up the road ahead of him.
But keeping in mind how far back he started, it's been a remarkable run. And I happen to think that the tire wear on that car will not be as severe because of the weight. Very different cars, so he might be in better shape as far as tire wear goes.
Watching the race leader on the banking, Stu Haener. More on tires from Jan Beekes.
Well, these are the tires that came off Jason Priestley's car, and he went over to the crew immediately and said that these Hoosier tires are going off immediately. You can see how much rubber here has moved across the tire, and that's what they're concerned about. Obviously, this tire is not worn out. You can see these wear indicators at the moment. There's plenty of rubber on this tire, but once they reach a certain temperature and have been held there, that's what they're concerned about with the actual tire going off itself. Now, Jason was here a moment ago. He has stepped out, and we'll try and get a word with him as exactly what it feels like for a driver. Guys?
All right, thanks, Jan. Tire give up, it's called. Part of the black art of making racing tire compounds. As you mentioned, Marty, Hoosier only recently got into this game. Those tires will get better and better, and so will the racing.
Yeah, it's very difficult. It's very difficult for the tire manufacturer. It's very difficult for the teams and drivers, because this is the first time they've raced with this tire compound, with this tire.
Now, Bernie Cochran's now 5 seconds behind. So obviously, as these tires are wearing, it's having less effect on Stu as it is second place Bernie Cochran. So now, when do you pit? Do you stay out hoping for that yellow? We've had no indication. In fact, we've had very few cars sliding off course, let alone colliding. And how long do you give up that track space before you get David Murray into that number two car?
Well, I think the answer is that you wait as long as possible so that you can shorten your fuel stop. The less time spent in the pit lane to put fuel in the car, the better it is for track position.
Back down to Jan Beekes.
Jason Priestley has made his way back over here into the garage area where these tires came off of your car. Let's talk about tires. Did you expect when you started the race that you would have to change?
Yeah, we figured we would. We haven't raced on the Hoosier tires yet. They're a new spec tire for the series. So I don't think any of us really knew what to expect. I think we figured we probably would have to, and we did.
So how bad did they go off?
Well, they started to go off pretty quickly. They didn't go off too bad. I mean, it's not like they went off really sharply. They went off in a very gradual way. But Daytona's notorious for getting greasy as it is. So with the tires going away the way they were, with the increasing amount of grease out on the track, it just seemed to make sense to change them.
The strategy about pitting early, at least relative to the other competitors.
Yeah, well, in the car we talked about a lot of things, whether we should just follow the leaders or what we should do. And, I seem to be holding a pretty steady distance between myself and Bernie Cochran and Stewie Haener. But it just seemed to be the right time for us to do it. Scotty's a little bit faster than I am, so it seemed to be time to do it.
Thanks, Jason.
All right, thanks, John.
I've never heard him called Stewie Haener. That's new. Stewie.
There is the second place car. Bernie Cochran did not make up any additional ground on the leader on that lap, so everybody probably running on fairly clear track.
In fact, that was 5.606, and just as we showed the graphic, actually as it came off, it jumped to 5.9, so he's losing about 0.3 of a second a lap.
The ebb and flow of the gaps continues as the traffic continues to pose problems for the leaders. Four classes, each running their own race. Bernie Cochran on the move. Stu Haener out front. Pit action continues as well. We'll have all of it for you when we return live to Daytona. Back live at the Motorola Cup Daytona 2 Hour. Bob Marshall along with Jeremy Dale and Marty Reed. There is the third place car, Andy Pilgrim, who has made such a gallant charge through this field. Jan Beekes awaits him.
And Andy Pilgrim comes to bring this car to a stop. They are expecting to change two tires on this car. They've decided they will jack the back of the car up and they will change the two rear tires because they don't have much experience with the Hoosier tires. So we'll see that Terry Borchiller will get into the car now, being aided by Andy Pilgrim. And we'll keep an eye on the rear tire change. Now, what surprises me is that they are doing one tire at a time. In other words, they are jacking up the left side of the car, and then they'll go over and jack up the right side. I would assume that if you were changing rear tires, it'd be a whole lot faster to take this jack and stick it under the rear differential so that you could obviously do it that much quicker. But this is the way they have chosen. We are 40 seconds and counting at the moment. So judging by other cars we've seen here on pit road, guys, this is still a fairly quick stop. Right rear tire, sorry Bob, is going on now as we speak. And that seems to be going fairly routinely, but we're over a minute already, so this is green flag time. It's slipping away.
Interesting strategy. The rule is you cannot jack the entire car off the ground, all four wheels at one time. But there may not be the mechanical capability to raise the car from the rear and have both rear wheels off the ground so you can change them both at the same time.
And he just went a lap down as the 32 car of Stu Haener just went by start finish.
Well, it didn't really cost them a lot of time there. Basically, the fueling and the tire change probably cost them 2 or 3 seconds there. The fueling and the tire change took about the same amount of time.
And Bernie Cochran is coming into the pit lane, and that's a good move because he was losing 0.3 of a second a lap. They couldn't afford to stay out anymore.
Now, we'll be looking for a tire change here, Bill Weber.
I'll tell you one thing, this is a huge surprise because I had just finished talking to Bernie Cochran Sr. They were expecting the four car to come down pit road. They were going to take the tires off the four and check and see if they needed it. You can see David Murray is standing on the wall. He's just putting his gloves on. They were not prepared for this at all. This is some kind of an error. Bernie Cochran was not supposed to pit at this time. They wanted to bring in the fellow team car, the four car, take off the rear tires and check them to see if they'd have to put tires on this car. So now they're forced to make this change now. About to find out exactly what happened, but David Murray has climbed into the Pontiac Firebird. Bernie Cochran is fastening him in. His father looking over the wall, watching it, glances at the clock, putting fuel in. These are gravity-fed fuelers, so it does take a long time, as Jeremy was saying. So Bernie Cochran getting David Murray in the car. Some confusion down here, certainly a surprise to this team. We'll have to find out. Pretty soon, David will be on his way, waiting for the final ounces of fuel to flow into the tank, and then David Murray will begin the chase for the championship. championship of this race here at Daytona. Let's go further down pit road to Jan Beekes.
And Andy Pilgrim has climbed from his car, have the helmet off now. First of all, congratulations. A great job of driving. We enjoyed watching you work through the field. How's the car?
The car's absolutely perfect. I have to tell you, we had a pretty miserable practice and we missed qualifying. We just had teething problems. It's a semi-new team, certainly a new car, and you know, I'm new with the team. So it wasn't a real good practice qualifying, but that was superb. The car, everything came together. So far, so good.
Now, you did change two rear tires. Now, you jacked the left side and then the right side of the car. Is it possible just to jack up the back of the car and change them both at one time?
Yeah, but there's an issue with fueling the car, because you have to really lean the car to fuel it. So they kind of do one side, the opposite, and then they do the other side, just in case they have to change fronts.
Okay, there's the answer. Let's go back to Bill.
Bernie, what are you doing here?
Well, we lost radio contact early on, and I kept clicking and waving my hand the last lap trying to get him in, and I guess they weren't expecting me. There's not much I could do.
How is your car? Early on, it looked like you were catching Stu, then he appeared to be pulling away.
Yeah, I started catching him, and then I started using up the tires, and he's been doing this a little bit longer than I have, so he was a little better in traffic than I was.
How are your tires?
Pretty good. I think we'll be fine. We're in good shape. We'll let David take it to the finish.
All right, good luck.
Thank you.
So his teammate, David Murray, is out in fifth place, but still on the lead lap.
And that is key, because if we were to get a full course yellow at this stage and he was down a lap, he would remain down a lap, and that would really hurt them. So that is key to get out on that lead lap.
Murray, one of the drivers, as I mentioned, that will be performing in the Rolex 24 at Daytona, the 24-hour race that begins tomorrow afternoon here on ESPN2.
We're not getting a lot of slack here from the 39 car.
Steve McNeely, I believe, will make the change to Scott Arrington. There's the race leader, Stu Hayner.
And we understand that he may be pitting this lap. We do listen into their radio contact, but of course this is a multi-car team, so we have to be careful.
Well, his lead is a minute and 25 seconds over the four car of Bob Walton, and you got to believe that that's a good sizable lead.
Well, don't forget, Marty, they will be standing still for about a minute, or maybe even a little bit more, and a very long run down pit lane here at 60 miles an hour.
The zero car, Scott Maxwell, is moving through the field rapidly, working traffic. Our leader is in the pits.
And I think this is a good move, because remember the rule about if you go full course yellow, they bunch the field up because they keep pit lane closed. He's got the 1 minute, 25 second lead. They might as well take advantage of it.
Undoing the belts inside the cockpit, Stu Hayner preparing for the handover. Let's get to Will Weber.
John Heinrichsi with the helmet on. He will replace Stu Hayner. Window net is down, and Hayner is out of the car right after bringing it to a stop. Heinrichsi, who climbs in, test drives Corvettes for a living. A dream job if you can get it. Right front tire coming off, right front tire going on. They're also going to look at the right rear. Everybody else in this field is hoping this team will make a mistake on pit road, because these two drivers rarely will make them on the racetrack. Heinrichsi is in the car. Now they've gone to the rear tires on this Pontiac Firebird. Hayner is buckling him in. They're putting fuel in, jacking the rear of the car. Now the left rear is off, putting on a new left rear tire. So they will make a four-tire change on this car. So originally that was not the plan, but Hayner had reported that the car was getting a little loose out on the racetrack. So now Heinrichsi plugs in the radio. They will simply wait for the fuel. They don't need a full tank, but they will probably try and top off as much as possible just so they don't run the danger of running out. Now an official standing in front of the car. We'll have to wait and see if everything's okay here. Waiting for the fuel. The crew chief stands in front of the car. Joe Aquilani, the car owner, watches from the pits. Heinrichsi looking forward, still waiting on fuel. Remember, these are gravity fed. These are agonizing moments for the driver. Now they have the fuel tank out. They've got the cap on. The car is drunk. The 32 goes out, and he will remain the leader because the four car is coming down pit road, and it will go to the attention of Bernie Cochran Motorsports.
And that position is at the very end of pit lane as Rob Walton pulls into the pits. Meanwhile, back out onto the track comes John Heinrichsi as the crew talks it over. We'll be back with more from Daytona. Back live at Daytona International Speedway, Bob Barsha, Jeremy Dale, and Marty Reed with you for the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-Hour. And those are the first and second place cars in the race in the overall, the Grand Sports class. And the difference was purely pit stop, Jeremy.
Yeah, it was. David Murray's team able to make up a little bit. But I have to tell you, I'm extremely impressed with John Heinrich coming out of the pit lane and essentially being up to speed instantly. I mean, he literally came out of the pit lane. David Murray was coming up, was catching him, and instantly Heinrich was up to speed.
Well, the other thing, we got to give a tip of the hat to Bernie Cochran's team. Remember, they got caught short. They weren't expecting the two car in. They got him out, and they were, remember, over 7 seconds down. Now they're two.
Here's another battle. 25 to the left of your screen, fourth. The zero car of Scott Maxwell is fifth. And just behind them, right there, the number 54, Jerry Borcheller, is running in sixth place. Now the 25 car pits from fourth place, so it becomes a battle for fourth between Maxwell and Borcheller. Jan Bikas,
the number 25 car as well. We're going to see how quick this pit stop is. We do see the jack ready, so we will see some tires changed here. We'll wait to see exactly how many that may be. First thing the crew does is go to the tires to look at them to see, in fact, if they do need replacing. And now it appears as though the only tires that are going to be changed, at least at this juncture, are going to be those on the right side of the car. Now, interesting, we are adding some oil to the engine at the moment. Seems like they knew ahead of time that this particular engine may burn a little bit of that valvoline that they're putting in the car right now. But of course, these pit stops, as Bill has put it so well, these are agonizingly long pit stops, so they actually have plenty of time to do things like add oil, change tires, and so on. Now, Peter Sachs was in the car. Chuck Snipes is now buckling into the car, so we obviously have the mandatory driver change going on. And I do see a few other tires on the pit wall, but it appears as though the right side tires are the ones being changed. Bill, you've got some action too.
Touring leader is in, Joe Nonnemaker is out, Bill Pate is climbing in, and these two guys, different body sizes, so you have to keep that in mind when you're setting up your race car. But they've got their car here, the 43 car on pit road. A limited amount of cars in this class today, but Nonnemaker, who owns this team, is really hoping that they can showcase just how strong their team is in this race today. He'll run around and guide Pate out of the pits, not changing tires on this car. The Mazda is down, and it's a way to eat a lot of fuel. So John Nonnemaker sends Bill Pate back out onto the track.
Nonnemaker from Massillon, Ohio. Bill Pate from Lafayette, Indiana. Pate takes the car back out of the racetrack.
This is a great shot here from up above. Watch how this road tightens up right there with that guardrail. Many, many drivers over the years have crashed leaving the pits here, and that's exactly why.
Including some very well-known names. Meanwhile, back up on the lead, John Heinrichi, with traffic ahead of him. Now, he's been able to pull away slightly from the second place car, David Murray, but there is traffic up ahead as they head for the banking. Now, we're having multiple pit stops by one of our cars that was contending.
The power here on Heinrichi's car to go around the BMW.
Let's get to Jan Bikas.
Well, we were watching that pit stop of car number 25, the Ford Mustang. They had a brilliant pit stop. They would have been done in about 1 minute 15 seconds, but then there was a problem inside the car. Chuck Snipes could not get the seat belts to his liking. They had to take the window net back down again and make an adjustment. That is so frustrating when the crew is able to get everything done to their liking, but then the driver just doesn't have things, the belts in this case, where they should be. An agonizingly long 1 minute 51 second pit stop.
After all of that work to get to this position in the race.
And that car actually smokes a little bit, so I'm not surprised they had to add a little bit of oil to that car. You see how the Mazda a little bit better under braking there.
Well, we see more than one car on the racetrack. The tendency is to believe that the heavier, more powerful cars are going to be better all around. We see graphic evidence today, that's not always the case. Cars and the compacts will be better under braking and may handle a lot more nimbly and the big grand sports cars.
Oh yeah, I mean, you know, braking has everything to do with weight and momentum, and to slow these very heavy cars down, even though they have enormous brakes, takes incredible amount of stopping power.
This is for position 94 and 18, running 9th and 10th.
Look at this rear-to-rear through turn 6, back up onto the banking, going under the 328 BMW.
Is it smoke from the 94 car? Now that silver BMW, number 81 up high on the track, is a class leader. Leader in the sports class.
Yeah, and what's remarkable about that, that car sitting 8th overall, and the second place sports car sitting back in 19th overall. What that tells me is that the 81 car probably has not stopped for fuel at this point.
I'm watching that 94 car on the back stretch. Seems to be smoking from the back.
Yeah, Craig Conway, remember we saw that little piece of material flapping earlier. I have no idea if it's connected, but there does appear to be smoke coming from Conway's number 94.
Well, it doesn't seem to be too short on horsepower. As he comes up out of the chicane, onto the banking, horsepower seems to be fine.
That's a cross-border driving team. Peter Lockhart from Toronto, right here at Daytona Beach, back on the lead. 32, Heinrichsen. Whoops, now a team car. That's the 39 machine. Scott Harrington, I'm not sure if they've made their pit stop. You see, he's pulled down near the pit entrance, but there's no way he's going to get it all the way in. Well, I say that. Is he going to try and push it?
Well, this certainly shouldn't bring out a full course yellow. It's in a very safe place, and they'll either leave it there or bring a truck out and just flat tow it in. But it shouldn't be cause for a full course caution.
He's pushing that car. Meanwhile, up front, John Heinrichsen continues on his way. Expanding his lead over David Murray out to almost 3 seconds now. We'll be back to Daytona. Welcome back to the Motorola Cup Daytona 2 hour. There's your leader, John Heinrichsen, as the pit stops continue, as does the position swapping on the racetrack. Coming up on ESPN tonight at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time, the ladies' final from the Australian Open, first Grand Slam tennis tournament of the year. It'll be Conchita Martinez versus number one seed Martina Hingis, number one female player in the world. It's coming your way at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time tonight on ESPN. Whoops, we've got a car off and apparently dead in the greenery on the infield portion here at Daytona.
Well, it's got battery power. You can see the right front brake smoking there. That's what that smoke is coming out of the right front corner.
Our number 53, J.J. Kelly from Plantation, Florida. Kenneth Goldberg from the same town. Oi, got it fired again. Whoops, but he does have damage.
This looks like it's back in the chicane. Is this the chicane?
We're about to find out.
That's not the chicane. That is the International Horseshoe.
Hairpins, yep.
That is some big time understeer right there.
Well, he had a moment to stop and think about it. Now he pulls off onto the safety road behind the barrier and parks it. There is the view to the International Horseshoe. Gives you an idea of how far he traveled. Meanwhile, in the chicane, rush hour traffic. Find out what's going on with our front running car. Here's Bill Weber.
I'm with Stu Hayner, and I've watched Hayner and Heinrichsen work their magic for years. Is it going to happen today? How's your car?
The car is great. Whether we can work the magic, I don't know. I mean, this is actually the best position we've been in a long time at this point in the race. But the car was really wonderful. I mean, we were a little confused and debating on how we're going to set the car up because we didn't know what was going to happen toward the end of the stint. But I think we must have hit it pretty close because we're still running some pretty good lap times at the end. The car is great. I mean, I was taking care of the brakes, taking care of the tires, taking care of the fuel. And you know, I think, if John can, if everything goes our way, we're gonna pull this deal off, I hope.
And it's a little trouble getting to the old bus stop.
Well, the bus stop is, that thing surprised you all the time because, if somebody just drops a little bit of gravel on there, you don't see it till you get in there, and all of a sudden, you just slide. And in fact, I even did it on the very first lap. It was like I got in there and I'm not sure if a couple cars that went through on the parade lap might have gone in there, but all of a sudden it was pretty doggone slick. But then after that, the next lap, it was fine. You know, well, maybe the next lap after that, because I was sort of testing at the third lap. But yeah, the car was fine.
All right, good luck.
Thank you very much, Bill.
That's Stu Hainer. Let's go to Jan.
Bill, earlier we talked to Jason Priestley after he got out of one car. He is now back in the 46 Ford Mustang. So he's driving two cars today in this race. He's in a battle right now on the racetrack, but there's a concern by race officials that they have seen the window net flapping on that car. Now, of course, if the window net comes down, he will have to come on pit road and fix it. So they're hoping that maybe it's just not as tight as it should be. Guys?
Well, I'm sure we can get a little close-up camera work and either come to their aid or completely blow them out of the water.
Yeah, they're running eighth right now. The last thing they want is for us to give away the fact that now the window net's there.
That window net's in perfect shape. Nothing wrong with that.
Grave responsibility of television. It looks like the lower left, like the back seat corner of that thing, may be loose. The front edge looks okay. What a day Jason Priestley is having, driving two different cars, both of them in the top 10 throughout this race.
Well, interesting thing in this series, which I read in the rules, is that you can actually score points in two cars if the cars are in different classes, which I thought was a very interesting rule, because that means you could actually win two championships in the same series if you were to play it right. You'd really have to play it right.
Everything would have to fall your way. Number three heads for the pit lane.
That's the team car to Bernie Cochran and David Murray.
Now the 94 has pitted behind him. It's Craig Conway pitting from ninth place. This is the car that was smoking. Looks like the hood's going up. Jan Vinkes.
And we're going to look with you as we go into the engine compartment to see where that smoke may be coming from. You can see that it's kind of coming from back behind the engine, and of course the fan, which is mandatory on this particular car, it's not on most race cars, that's tending to blow the smoke around a little bit here. They have checked the oil. There is oil, some left anyway, in the engine, and looks like they're going to send the 94 back out again because they appear as though the smoke, and that's the important thing, we're looking behind the car, there's no oil on the actual pit road, so that shouldn't be a problem. The race officials should let them continue.
Good thing about having a radiator fan. Look, no smoke.
And this is one of the few Camaros, guys. This the Grand Sports cars dominated by the Firebirds. One of the few Camaros that is running out there. And that car's not running on ethanol, by the way, just in case there's some confusion there.
That has cost him time on the racetrack. Currently shown in 11th position and a lap down is Craig Conway. Up front, John Heinrichsi boring into the dust kicked up in the chicane. Plenty of time still to run. We'll be back with more from Daytona after this. Back live at Daytona, a great battle on the infield headed for the International Hairpin. Car number 11, Doug Goad, being drawn up under braking by that BMW M3 of Terry Borcheller.
Yeah, and I think it's only a matter of time. Terry has been closing in the last few laps. You see the Pontiac pulls about a half a car length there on the run up to the kink.
Jan Vinkes has more on the number 11 car situation.
Yes, and Jeremy Dale was talking about it earlier that this is a leased car. The reason it is leased is because a Pontiac Firebird Trans Am, a brand new one, is very, very hard to get a hold of. So they actually leased it from a Canadian dealer, and then they took it back to the States and modified it. It is the only one in the field. It has an aluminum engine. It's brand new. It should be fast, but right now it looks like the BMW might be faster.
Well, the 11 car got caught out there a little bit, was trying to defend his position, going into turn six. You can see nothing like horsepower, and I think Doug Goad probably is going to be a little more defensive than Devin Powell was. He got caught out at six and ran a little wide. The BMW took the short line up onto the banking, but I think, guys, it's only a matter of time here. A little bit defensive into the bus stop, dropping a wheel at that second apex.
Going to want to get a good launch off this corner up onto the banks.
Yeah, boy, that BMW handles so well.
So look at a field summary, upper left corner. John Heinrichi running in first place. David Murray, Doug Goad, Terry Borchiller. That's the battle we're watching right now. Scott Maxwell, they're 6th through 10th.
And the lead has dropped from 7 seconds to 5.5.
In 12th position, the leader in the sports class, Mike Fitzgerald in a BMW. Back in the 19th spot, the leader in the touring class is Bill Pate in a Mazda MX-6. And in position 21 is the compact class leader, the Olds Achieva of Ed Magner. The leader was in some heavy traffic while we were watching that battle behind him.
Yeah, that gap at the front has closed up a little bit.
Murray shows 5.64 seconds behind John Heinrichi.
And here we are back to that battle for third. And this could be a good opportunity for Borchiller. He could throw it in. Yeah, here he goes. Under braking. BMW very good on the brakes, and he forces Goad out. Goad did leave a small hole there. And Borchiller moves up to third position. Now the question is, can Goad stay close enough here under braking, going through turn six, to get that position back going down to the chicane? I don't think he's close enough, guys.
Oh, the tail end came out on him, too. The car's not handling all that well.
This battle taking place about 45 seconds behind David Murray in second place. So these guys are basically fighting over third to the flag with less than 20 minutes to go in this race. Jan Beekes.
Well, you're talking about that white BMW number 54. The crew's big concern is that the car is working just how they would like, with the exception of they really don't feel that they have the horsepower of the Pontiac. And obviously that is something that we have seen play into this battle back and forth, that they may have the handling, but they feel that no matter what they do, they'll never be able to match that kind of horsepower on the straightaways.
That's a great, great illustration of how the Pontiac can close up on the banking. But once that BMW gets by, it's very hard for the Pontiac to get back around him. Look at this, they come into traffic here. Closing rate is pretty phenomenal.
Car number 48, that Oldsmobile there, that may be our compact class leader. Here comes the Pontiac. Big time horsepower pulling by, but now where the BMW shines on the twisty bits of the infield.
Boy, that's not what Terry Borchiller wanted. He wanted to be able to maintain that position. Look at Goad, very wide there. He wanted to be able to maintain that position into the infield so he could stretch it out. Look at how early Goad has to turn and scrub speed on the entry, and that does hurt him on the exit. Look at the BMW on the exit. Closes right up.
Now, where are you going? Left or right?
Now,
kink left coming up.
Now, here comes the kink. Will Goad leave that gap open on the inside as he did last lap?
That's why they call it a wide track Pontiac.
Getting wider all the time.
Yeah, and he did not leave that gap open.
Yeah. Oh, look at the tail. He got the back end loose. He's hanging on. I mean, obviously, I think the weight of the vehicle and the pressure that Borchiller's put on there is basically taking the tires out from underneath Doug Goad.
Yeah, look at Borchiller, does turn a little bit later, kind of squares the corner a bit more, but definitely has the better exit speed. The problem is he doesn't have the horsepower, and you can see the Firebird there.
High goes Goad. Borchiller really squared off the entrance to the chicane last time around. Let's see if he tries that again. Of course, now he's not going to have the lead this time.
No, he's not going to have the lead.
Remarkable weight difference between these two cars. 2,850 pounds for the BMW. The Pontiac, 3,200 pounds.
Yeah, very different lines. And that is partially driving style and partially what the car wants. The BMW, a lighter car, can turn in much more directly than the Firebird.
As that battle cools a bit for the moment, back up on the lead, John Heinrichi has pulled out to a 9.3 second lead over David Murray. So things are going his way. Heinrichi and Hayner try to lead from flag to flag here at the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-Hour. High above of perhaps the most famous beach in motorsports, or in sports generally, Daytona Beach, site of the Rolex 24 at Daytona, beginning tomorrow. We'll be here on ESPN2 at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time with 30 minutes of preparation for one of the world's great sports car classics. And then at 1 o'clock, the green flag will fly and we'll be underway for twice around the clock, the Rolex 24 36th edition. 3 hours of coverage beginning at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, and then on Sunday at 7 a.m. Eastern will be coming your way with all the highlights of what happened through the night as we run down the last 6 hours, 25% of the total distance, to the checkered flag, with interviews and race recaps to follow. Here is the top 10 in the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-hour. John Heinrichi having taken over from Stu Hayner. They have led since the green flag dropped. David Murray now 12.88 seconds back and fading. Doug Goad in the middle of a great battle with Terry Borcheller and a Pontiac versus BMW battle. And then Scott Maxwell rounding out the top five. These great late afternoon aerial shots are coming to you from the Bud One Airship, which reminds you that fresh beer tastes better. This is for third place. They are still at it. Three wide, side by side, door handle to door handle, and they've got some heavy braking coming up.
And side by side through the kink. Whoa, big slide there by Doug Goad through that kink, about 120 miles an hour. And he's pretty much forced to let Terry Borcheller go through there. And these guys have pretty much been exchanging positions every lap.
Yeah, but the tires are getting more and more worn on the 11 car. You can watch it every time Doug Goad goes through a corner, he's sliding.
Less than 14 minutes to go. And around a 3.5 mile racetrack, that's just a handful of laps. Jan Beekes.
Well, right as you guys were describing that big slide by car number 11, the crew jumped to action, and we expect to see the yellow car number 11 on pit road. I assume that Doug Goad says or has said on the radio that he has a tire going down. They ran for the tires, so we may see that third place battle end here on pit road.
Well, if it does, they're going to lose more than just third place. They are just 26 seconds ahead of the fifth place car. Oh, car number two, David Murray, our second place car, is off and steaming.
And that is not good. His day is done. He's out of the car. And that looks like steam. It doesn't look like fire. It looks like steam. Bill, can you help us?
I'd like to help you, but I came running down here to find out from Bernie Cochran what was the matter with the two car. He's the owner of this team, and he's asking me. Remember, they have had no radio contact with that car, David Murray, the driver. So I came running down here. He's going, what's wrong? What's wrong? And I said, we got to report your car's off the track. He said, find out for me. So
well,
we all found out together.
You can tell him. It looks like steam coming out from under the hood, and David has gotten out of the car. He's climbed over the wall. The hood is down, and he's parked, and his helmet is off.
So the day goes up in a cloud of steam after a great drive by both Bernie Cochran and David Murray up front. That gives huge breathing room to John Heinrichi. His gap over the new second place car of Terry Borcheller, 51.22 seconds. And we are down to just about 12 minutes to go in this 2-hour run.
Are you tuning up your vocal cords, Jeremy?
It's Osei Can You See by the Dawn's Early Light.
Guys are
well, you've still got a chance. I mean,
yeah, we got a chance. I mean, you know, like four or five cars could break here.
Maxwell will move into fourth place because of Murray's mishap, so you've only got three to get by.
What about if I put a guy on the podium? How about that? Can we redo the deal?
Oh, now we're backsliding.
Can we renegotiate?
51 seconds and climbing. John Heinrichi running out the string with the sun in his eyes on a beautiful afternoon at Daytona Beach, Florida. We'll be back. Long shadows cast on NASCAR turns 1 and 2 at the world-renowned Daytona International Speedway. Then out into the fading light of a Florida afternoon comes our race leader, John Heinrichi, in his Pontiac Formula. He and partner Stu Hayner, who started this car, have led from the first green flag of the day in this 2-hour battle for the new Motorola Cup Series. Neatly through the traffic in the chicane.
One of the things that the Motorola Cup did, which obviously some people liked, some people didn't, they got rid of the turbos. Last year, if you were here with us, the Toyota Super Turbo sat on the pole with Eric Van Cleef. And now with all normally aspirated, they just felt it was too hard to patrol, and they decided to unload it.
And very hard to police the turbo cars. I mean, you can put little boost regulators on them. You can put little computers that measure the peak boost. It's just too tricky to keep track of all that.
Let's pick up one of the good battles going on. Back in the compact class, the old Achieva, Magna and Norton leading the Hyundai Tiburon in its first appearance in this series. One of the drivers on that, Didier Schrenin. Whoops. And the leader in the class is slowing on the infield. The six car is about 4 seconds, has already gone by, we are told. And so a dramatic twist in the action in the compact class. There is the number six Hyundai. That car being shared, as I was saying earlier, by Marc Craig from Saint-Eustache, Quebec, and from Mount Saint-Hilaire, Quebec, Didier Schrenin, who doubles as a television racing talent on French TV in Quebec.
Now, let me get this straight. This is a Canadian car.
I knew that was coming.
We never stipulated what class. We said winner.
Oh, what a tough break for these guys who have led this class for roughly an hour at this point. Ed Magner behind the wheel. Buddy Norton started the car.
Yeah, Buddy very experienced in these cars.
You know, this is the first time a Hyundai has raced in any of these American series, no matter who's been sanctioning. So this would be a big feather in their cap to take the victory here in the compact class.
They are in the lead right now with about eight, make that a little under 8 minutes to go in the race. Bill Weber.
Well, it could be a number of things. I'm here with Buddy Norton. We're hearing CV clutch, CV joint clutch, axle. Any ideas?
No, but if it's any one of those things, we're done anyway. We're not even sure where Ed is right now. He's parked, okay. So that's the end of that.
But it was a great run.
Real good, yeah. The car ran fine. The Hyundai guys were real fast, keeping us fast. That's the way it goes.
Okay, that's Buddy Norton, co-driver on that car, and this is something we will see throughout the 24-hour race. Great runs that end too early.
Bill, you can tell him his car is parked on the kink, on the infield stretch between the two hairpins. Now the touring class, the Mazda MX-6, number 43, Joe Nonnemaker and Bill Pate leading the way over a similar car. VW Golf GTI in third. And this battle is not over yet in the waning minutes of this race. The shadows drifting across, the light beginning to come down. A lot of glare in the driver's eyes as they come down through the tri-oval area.
Yeah, that's Starita's car in second place there on their screen. That's really the 47 car.
That's a Grand,
Grand
Sport
car. John Kohler, Gary Smith.
John Kohler, Gary Smith, number 47. Down to Bill Weber.
Well, it could be a good day for Planet Earth, huh? Planet Earth Motorsports. Joe Nonnemaker, your car is running 1-2.
Yep, it's going to be a great day for Planet Earth. If we don't activate the race gods here, we got 5 minutes left. We're running 1-2 right now. It's just really great.
We talked earlier today, not a lot of cars in this division here today, but a chance for you to really showcase what you've got in this series.
Yep, that's very true. There weren't a lot of cars showed up, and it's really unfortunate, but you know what? Not being egotistical, this is our fifth straight win in this class at this track. This is our track for these cars, so we got number five. We don't care who else is here.
Not yet, you don't. Not yet, you don't.
True. I'm sorry, guy.
He started the 43 car, and Bill Pate's in there now.
Well, earlier we showed you a graphic which said that David Murray held the record for wins, consecutive wins at a single racetrack by a driver. He had 5 wins at Sebring, Florida. So we could be seeing a little history here as you look at the number 43 car, Bill Pate, the leader in the touring class. Barely 5 minutes to go in the race. Back to our overall leader up high, going around the compact class leader. That's the sort of thing we get in a series like this. John Heinrichi, with just a handful of laps remaining. You see the gap has come down, but 3/4 of a minute should be more than enough for Heinrichi to feather it all the way around. Just a lap or two from the finish. Stand by for more from Daytona. We'll be right back. We are back live at Daytona International Speedway. Bob Barsha along with Marty Reed, Jeremy Dale, Bill Weber, and Jan Bikas, as we will be for tomorrow's Rolex 24 at Daytona. Right now it's the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-hour, and we expect a white flag shortly for our race leader, John Heinrichsi. They have led from flag to flag, Heinrichsi and his teammate Stu Hayner. The car behind them, 41 seconds back up the road. Terry Borcheller and Andy Pilgrim started 25th. They currently run in second place. And the white flag waves over John Heinrichsi. One more lap of this 3.56-mile racetrack to go, and they will have the inaugural victory in the Motorola Cup.
And I must say, they have driven from a team standpoint, from a driving standpoint, it's just been perfect. I mean, they've made no mistakes.
The last time that a team went wire to wire back in 1994 at Indianapolis Raceway Park, winning flag to flag, it was a 3-hour race. Guess who was driving? Stu Hayner, John Heinrichsi.
Probably in a Canadian-built Firebird.
It's not going to help you, buddy.
I don't know, Marty.
Warm it up.
Jan and Bill and I might have to go into conference on whether or not we're going to hold Jeremy to it.
Warm it up, baby.
Okay, Marty has cast his vote.
I think we're only on the air for like another 10 minutes. I think we're going to run out of time. You got to get all the winner interviews. I mean, there's so much to do.
Actually, the lead's dropped down to 39 seconds, but I hate to tell you, that's an American in that car, too.
Yeah, I know.
And that's a German car. I mean, I'm going to have that to fall back on.
John Heinrichsi, the chief engineer for the Pontiac Firebird and Chevy Camaro projects, has been doing this for a long time. Won the championship in what was then called the Sports Car Club of America Escort Endurance Championship for this sort of race car in the Grand Sports Division. He also won the IMSA version of what was called Showroom Stock Racing in 1989. 93, another SECA National Championship. 96, the IMSA title again. And last year, what was called the Speed Vision Cup in the Grand Sports Class. Car number 81 is the leader in the Sports Class. And just ahead is the third place car in the Grand Sports Class. Doug Goode had such a huge battle with Terry Borcheller's BMW. In the stretch run now, coming off NASCAR 3 and 4, John Heinrichsi from Holly, Michigan. And the checkered flag will wave from the flag stand. Car number 32, John Heinrichsi, picks up the victory, co-driving with Stu Hayner. Inaugural winners and deserving ones, a flag-to-flag victory in the Motorola Cup Daytona 2-hour. There's Stu Hayner accepting congratulations from the crew. There is car number 81, our leader in the sports class. That is Mike Fitzgerald. Jeff McMillan started the car. Fitzgerald will finish it. 96 BMW 328 IS.
Bob, we're getting a report that Borcheller may be running into fuel problems here on the last lap in the BMW.
Well, he's coming to the line right now.
He's coming to the line now.
And he is safely across. As we watch Mike Fitzgerald now heading into the setting sun for the final time today. And he takes the checkered flag in the sports division.
Doug Goode has crossed the line third overall.
In the touring division, there is car number 43, Bill Pate, who is on a lap of his own, so he will be unchallenged. He too heads into the sun and the checkered flag, completing the race in the third of our four classes. And we'll be looking for the leader in the compact class. Mike Craig in car number 6, the Hyundai. And what a weekend for these guys in a car that had been never raced in this sort of competition in North America. They come out and take their debut win. Let's begin the victory celebration down to Jan Bikas.
And yes, and who better to celebrate with than Stu Hayner? Now, Stu, first of all, congratulations, but you're known as a driver who protects the equipment. Is that what made the difference today for you?
Well, I'd like to hope so. I had it pretty easy, actually, today. Car was really, really well set up today, and the crew just had the car working perfect, and I didn't have to do that much work. to go fast. So I guess I was protecting it. But when John got in the car, it was as good as a, you know, as a, good as it gets, I think. The brakes were fine. We hardly had to use the brakes. And the mileage seemed to be really good. I think everything was really good on the car today.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations indeed to Stu Haner and John Heinrichsen. Yet another victory in their glittering career, co-driving with one another. We'll take a break and then have more of the victory celebrations, the first of Speed Week's 98 from Daytona. There is the view from the all-new Daytona International Speedway Victory Lane up to the Bud One Airship. Thanks, guys, for those great aerial shots today. We'll see you tomorrow for the rollout for the Rolex 24. Meanwhile, down in that brand-new Victory Lane, John Heinrichsen has rolled it in. Bill Weber is down there.
And John Heinrichsen about to climb out, get a handshake from his teammate Stu Haner. Well, I was there that night. You led wire to wire at Indianapolis. You repeated it here today. That's a great run.
Were we to wire to wire this time?
Yes, sir.
How about that?
That other guy, Haner, started it off.
Yeah, yeah, I know that guy.
A great run for you.
Thank you. Boy, Stu did a great job for me. The car was just like it was supposed to be. It was in perfect condition. The crew did a good job. We decided to change tires in that stop and make sure we had enough gas, and they did everything perfect. We had good tires, brakes, and, you know, what more could you want? The crew did a great job with the Pontiac Firebird.
You appeared to have a comfortable lead, but were you aware the two car fell out, and when were you aware?
I was aware when I went by in the infield and saw him smoking there. So up until then, I didn't know that. I did know he was back about 8 or 10 seconds most of the time and holding right about there. And I was worried, but when they said he went out, then it felt a lot better.
Great way to start the season.
You bet. It's a great start.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
To Jan Bikas.
Well, we saw a great battle on the racetrack today between the car number 54, the BMW, and the car number 11. First of all, Doug Goad, you were in the number yellow, the yellow 11, I should say. Tell me about this battle. You had more power. He seemed to have better handling, but in the end, looks like he got you.
Yeah, handling always wins over power, trust me. We stopped for fuel a little bit early, and the tires were cooked, and Bill had me absolutely covered on the infield. He was underneath, around, on top, and all I was doing is just powering around him when I got a chance in the straights. Once in a while, I get a break in traffic, and then finally he got a big break, and I couldn't make it up. He did a great job. It was a lot of fun.
Terry, tell me, your particular case here, the BMW, what can you do to make it go a little quicker down the straightaway to then try to go for the overall?
I think the key with the BMW is to try to pull in the draft to somebody like Doug, because that's really, he said it pretty well. We had him covered in the handling, he had us covered on the top, and Andy did a great job giving me a car that was just like when we put it out there. So he always does. I knew he would, but it was a great race. I think the draft plays a big part. I was sucked up under him a couple of times. Yeah.
Now, what would have happened if you had not had to start from the back, if you would have started, let's say, on the front row?
Andy and I both stayed out of trouble real well. I don't think the results would have been any different, because I don't think there was any way we could have kept up with the Pontiac that won. I think we were about 50 seconds down or something like that. We were quite a ways back. So we might have gave him a run, but I don't think so. Not today, not on this track, but we'll get him next time.
All right, guys, congratulations to all. It was the best race of the day. Thanks.
39.38 seconds was the margin of victory. John Heinrichsen over Terry Borcheller. Final results, Heinrichsen over Borcheller, Doug Goad, and of course all of these men had teammates. Grand Sports Cars, 1st through 10th. 11th through 20th includes our sports winner, Mike Fitzgerald. Also our touring class winner, Bill Pate, along with the compact class winner, the Craig Hyundai. As we run down through the field, final thoughts on what appeared to me to be a great debut for this series, Marty Reed.
Well, round one goes to the Americans, and I want to hear the national anthem there, Jeremy.
Well, guys, I was talking to our producer, Neil Goldberg, in the booth, and he tells me we can't get music clearance on that. So
Francis Scott Key has been dead for a long time. I don't think it's a problem.
I'm Francis Scott off key.
All right, well, you may be buying. Maybe we'll let you off the hook.
Okay, I'll buy some beers, you know? Okay. Not dinner, but a couple of beers.
Well, we didn't want to ruin the Shop Talk audience anyway. They're coming up next.
Congratulations to everyone involved. Bill Weber, what do you expect tomorrow when we roll out for the Rolex?
I'll tell you one thing. I think this really sets the tone for that race, because, you know, this is basically an endurance series. And still, it's the little things that can get you right down at the end. We saw some cars run extremely well but not make it to the finish. We saw that in the 24-hour race last year. It's really the unique things that happen in the 24-hour race that make it so exciting. That half hour that leads up to the race and then the green flag, it's 24 and a half hours of the most exciting racing of the season.
And Bill, you know, one thing that I've been saying throughout the qualifying coverage is that I think that we talk about the tortoise and the hare. I think that the hare is going to win this particular race. And that's because I think there's enough fast cars that if one fast car does not have problems, that will go to the front. Bob?
All right, thanks one and all, gentlemen. Don't forget, tomorrow, the reason we came to Daytona, the Rolex 24 will be on the grid at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time. So be sure to join us as we get you set for one of the great sports car races in all the world. At 1 p.m. Eastern Time, the green flag will fly, and we will be on our way with 3 hours of live coverage before we say goodnight for the moment. Then on Sunday morning, we'll have all the highlights of what happened from the time we left you on Saturday afternoon, and we'll have 6 more hours of live coverage all the way up to the checkered flag with 30 minutes of post-race to follow. It's going to be a great race. The drama begins early and runs twice around the clock. Today, however, it was the debut of a great new racing series, a Canadian-American Motorola Cup. Congratulations to Stu Hayner and John Heinrichsi on their win. Shop Talk is coming up next here on ESPN2. Be sure to join us tomorrow for the Rolex. Until then, I'm Bob Barsha for Jeremy Dale, Marty Reed, Bill Weber, and Jan Vinkas. So long for the moment from the gleaming Daytona International Speedway in Daytona Beach, Florida. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.